السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful, all praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Complete blessings and salutations be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless him and his companions and bless all those who have struggled and strived to protect this deen and to pass it on in such a way that it came to us thereafter. May Allah bless them and grant them a complete reward. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and bless our offspring and keep us all on deen. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and dearest listeners, this evening we will be speaking about the youth. The youth would include both male and female. Every time we have a lecture for the youth, there is a debate. Debate about who is the youth. Everyone claims to be young. Even a person who is now 60, 70, 80, they say, but I'm still young. So we say, no problem. It's fine. So long as the message is taken and understood, and each one should pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah open the doors for him or her. And my prayer is that I learn a lesson from my own words before yourselves. It is relevant for me before it is for yourselves. It always brings great joy to witness Muslim youth. Whenever I travel and I see a person appearing as a Muslim, male or female, it brings joy in the heart, subhanallah. There is an automatic link and connection. That is the first duty. The first duty is to appear as a Muslim. Let us understand, we want to be recognized as Muslims. Tell me, on the Day of Judgment, how many people will there be? Have you ever thought of it? Today, if you look at this masjid, there are thousands of people. To recognize one person out of these will be quite a mission. But if something is making that person stand out, it would become easier. So on the Day of Qiyamah, there will be trillions and quadrillions, pentillions, nonillions and decillions of people. You ask me how I know these figures, I am a Zimbabwean. We have had 4% inflation in the last few years. So our figures shot up. They removed 26 zeros from our currency. And still the rate was 100 trillion to one. Anyway, let's get back to what we were saying. So many people, because from the time of Adam alayhi salam up to the last person who will ever live, and when the trumpet will be blown, every single person shall be resurrected. Everyone. They will all be standing. All of them. How will me and you be recognized? Let's be honest. If we don't want to be recognized as Muslims in the dunya, how do we expect to be recognized as Muslims in the akhirah? When there are going to be more people and there's going to be a more difficult situation, is that one evidence not enough to make me want to at least appear as a Muslim? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us. Today, some people are shy to appear as Muslim because they feel maybe I will be associated with terrorism. I might be associated with certain individuals who have done deeds that we are not very proud about. But I know and you know that your religion needs to be promoted in the correct way. If you are going to evade and hide, then where are they going to see that there are people like you? If you think you are good, then at least appear to be a Muslim so that people can now see that Muslims are also good. It reminds me of the Muslim schools. Some parents who know that there are Muslim schools around and they still want to send their children to private schools, though they live right next door, their argument is that the standard of education is not high there. And I always tell them, well, we are waiting for your intelligent children to come here so our standards can go up, inshallah. The same applies if people think that by me dressing as a Muslim, I am going to have a bad image, then shaitan has already taken hold of them. Rather, by you dressing as a Muslim, there is something you can do to change the image of Islam that is wrong and bring it back to what it's supposed to be. May Allah use us to spread the true word. So it is very important that we appear as Muslims. It brings happiness to the heart when we see Muslimin. But at the same time, a question we have is this only an outward appearance? Is it only your name that sounds Muslim? I know of some Muslims who have changed their names solely because they don't want it to sound Muslim anymore. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. Really. Very few. I actually know of one, not some, one. But that one was enough to hurt me so much that we feel embarrassed that as ulama of this deen, maybe we are at fault that we did not convey the message quick enough to them, to tell them it is a sign of acceptance. You named yourself, or you were named well before any of the incidents that occurred in recent times. Don't be shy. You can go ahead and make a difference. So the youth today, there are so many different angles that we can tackle this topic from, that we would remain here all night and we still would not do justice to the topic. But it is time that we looked at certain issues connected to the youth. Many times what happens is the parents have a child and they are so excited when the child is born. They give the child everything. They look after the child. The mother spends sleepless nights. The mother of the child literally does everything for that child, including the toilet. We know that. Because she has no option but to do that. If a small child happens to mess, the mother will clean the mess happily and thank Allah that that child is still healthy. And the father would spend money, come back home, spend time and so on, we hope. I spoke about it the other day. And as time passes, they will start making choices and decisions for their children according to what their brains tell them and according to what they may have heard from the ulama and from their religion, bearing in mind that they would like to protect the Islamic identity and at the same time provide the best for their children. Then what is happening across the globe is at the age of 15, 16, sometimes 17, sometimes 18, sometimes a little bit more, sometimes a little bit less.
A lot of children tend to forget the status of those parents completely. They've become youth. That is the first bubble and burst of energy that they felt in their lives. Every one of us seated here, there was a stage in our lives when we thought we were it. When we thought we were now powerful, we had energy, we were right. We wanted to do our things our way. We were the ones, and that's it. Everything must rotate around us. The adolescent age, as you grow into the youth, and that is the age where a person is made or broken. For this reason, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, speaking about seven categories of people who will be granted the shade of the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah, from amongst them he mentions, وَشَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي عِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. A youth, a youngster. And this would include male and female. Min bab al-taghlib. It would include male and female. Whom, a youth whom, during that age of adolescence and during the age of power and strength, he or she found himself or herself within the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They protected themselves in that bracket, subhanallah. Because that is the age where inquisitivity comes into the mind. And people want to try out this and do that and possibly do this and that and so on. You know, when an old man is smoking and throws his cigarette, at a certain age, maybe it's younger now, before it was a bit older, people would look at that stub. Though the cigarette is almost finished, one more small puff left of something really gone. And people look at it and start thinking, I wonder what that tastes like actually. If that person has then abstained from it and said, no ways, I've heard that this is bad, that's enough. Then that person has secured his or her place under the shade of the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there are two ways to learn. To learn by example or to learn by experience. To learn by example meaning to learn by being told, following someone, following an example. You are told, brother, this is wrong and this is right. You say, thank you very much, I appreciate it and I will abstain from this and I will do that. You learned by example of someone. The other way of learning is by experience. Nowadays, most people do not want to learn by example, they want to learn by experience. When you tell them a million times, brother, you will burn yourself, don't go there. Brother, I am warning you, don't marry that woman. Brother, I am telling you that really you will cry. And the brother says, no, that's it. Finished. I'm ready to sacrifice all of you. Finished. I'm gone. That's it. I'm moving. No. They want to learn by experience. Then they'll go in, get burnt, and come out. If they come out, still there is hope. But a lot of people go in and never come out. It's like a man whom he is told, don't dive into this ocean. There are sharks nearby. He says, no. Sharks? I'll bite the shark. And you try and tell him again, don't go in there, there are sharks. He says, no, don't worry, I'm an expert. You know, I'll bite the sharks. So, then he ends up going. When he goes, he will think he's doing a good deed. And he's swimming, and he's okay. Then suddenly, when he is taken by a shark, he will not return for anyone to say, you see, we told you. That example is already where a person is lost totally. But there might come a time, or once or twice, he might have come back without any bite. That will in fact encourage him to go again. That's how the youth are sometimes. You know, it reminds me on a lighter note of one incident that I mentioned to some of the brothers, that there was a man who came, one of the youngsters from the village, who was brought up in a hut, very far away from the cities. He never seen the city. And what happened is, He said, no, I am the cleverest, I am intelligent, I want to go to the city. And the people told him, listen, hang on, you want to go to the city, take someone with you who knows, you know, you can't go alone. Yeah, you will get so many things, the people will cheat you there, man. So he says, no, I will cheat them. Who are they? I'm clever. And he didn't listen. Anyway, he arrived at the city. I'm cutting a long story short. When he arrived at the city, as he jumped off the train, for the first time in his life, he saw a high-rise building. Building, for the first time, high-rise. 11 stories. So he started looking. Hey, what? How does this work? And he started seeing, one, two, he's looking. And someone realized this man is a villager. Really, let's try and see what we can achieve from him. So they looked at him and said, hey, what are you doing? He says, I'm just looking. You think it's free to look here? What do you mean you think it's free? What are you looking at? He says, I'm looking at this. So you're looking at this building. You need to pay. He says, I need to pay? Me? Now remember what he told the people in the village. He said, I am going to cheat them, isn't it? He says, I need to pay. He says, yes, you need to pay. It's not free. He says, okay, how much do I pay? The man says, 10 rupees for each floor that you looked at. How many floors did you look at? He says, I looked at 3 floors. He says, okay, give me 30 rupees. So he took out 30 rupees, he paid, and that man smiled and went away. When that man went away, this man started nodding his head. He said, you see, I cheated him. I looked at 10 stories, I only paid for 3. I looked at 10 stories, I only paid for 3. That is the example of what we say when you think you are too clever. Allahu Akbar. You think you are too clever. And no matter how hard people try to tell him, he still thinks he is the one who won the battle. He doesn't know. May Allah protect us from that type of foolishness. You know, it might be a light example, but the essence of it is very deep. It happens in our lives to us. We also look at buildings and we also end up paying and we also give the same answer, but we don't realize. So, as youth, we need to have a role model. That is a very, very important point of our lives. The ultimate role model is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But every single one of us, obviously, we need to have someone whom we see on a regular basis, whom we feel is exemplary, whom we would like to emulate to a great extent, bearing in mind that they are also human beings. If you notice a mistake from them, you will not emulate the mistake because they are not prophets. But you will try and emulate what you can. You know, what happens is we see business people and some youngsters say, I would like to be like that businessman. And they make an effort to work towards that. Correct. But what about our dunya? What about our deen? That is our dunya. What about our deen? We have people who want to become doctors. We have people who want to become lawyers. We have people who want to become accountants after seeing very successful doctors and lawyers and accountants, alhamdulillah. My dearest brothers and listeners, we need not doctors and accountants and lawyers. We don't need doctors, we don't need lawyers, we don't need accountants in our ummah. We need Muslim doctors. We need Muslim accountants. We need Muslim lawyers. We need a person who's firstly a Muslim and a doctor. A Muslim and an accountant. A Muslim and a plumber. A Muslim and a tailor. A Muslim and a driver and so on. So if someone only wants to have the one title, they are making a very big error. May Allah protect us. And this is why the one whom Allah has granted success is the one who knew how to strike a balance between this world and the next. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who can strike that balance. So if we have a role model, if we have someone we look up to, someone we would like to follow, someone we would like to emulate, and we closely follow the good characters and conducts of that particular person or individual, sometimes a group of individuals, preferably a scholar of this deen, preferably someone who is of a brilliant deeni standing. When I say deeni, I hope you know what I'm saying. I'm talking of a spiritual, religious standing. It does not mean that our role model has to be a person who divorces himself totally from this world. No, but someone whom we feel has struck the correct balance. But at the same time, it is not easy for us ourselves to select a role model. We will need guidance from those who love us most as to who should be our role model. I tell you why. What happens with us, we don't realize innama ya'rifu dhal fadli minan nasi dhawuhu. Definitely, those with a certain virtue shall only be recognized by people with a similar virtue. So a very highly qualified doctor will only be recognized by people of the medical fraternity who are as highly qualified. Others might not understand. A person who is a top scholar of the religion will only be recognized by others who are also top scholars of the religion. So a person who has noor will only be recognized by others who have some sort of noor as well. You know, I don't know about this part of the world, but in other parts of the world, there was a movie released known as The Message. In there, they are showing some history, Islamic history. And one man, he said, you know, I saw Hamza radiallahu anhu, he had so much noor on his face. Did you see? Allahu Akbar. And we told him, we said, brother, that was Anthony Quinn. His name is Anthony Quinn. He is an actor. He was just pretending to be someone. Allahu Akbar. He's a non-Muslim. He has nothing to do with Islam at all. And you are saying, I saw Hamza. He had so much noor. Allahu Akbar. What noor can we recognize? You need noor to recognize noor. Otherwise, you might see a person fair in complexion and think, mashallah, he has so much noor. Yet Bilal ibn Rabah was as dark as charcoal, but he had more noor than anyone else. Subhanallah. So it is very important that we choose our role models carefully. And it is best for us to have one of our parents as role models. And I am going to address the parents here momentarily. I'm sure a lot of you are parents. Please endeavor to be the role models of your own children. It is not difficult. Live an exemplary life. Speak professionally in the house. And learn to live a proper style of living. When you are eating, eat properly. Know that your children are watching you. The biggest school is the home. The biggest school is the house. If you are going to have yourself as a role model within the house, that child will not look elsewhere for guidance. The problem today is that a lot of homes have no light in it, no role model in it. The father has bad habits, the mother has bad habits. So the children then, they need to go and find a role model elsewhere. They open the television, they find an actor in Bollywood or Hollywood, and they find, for example, a singer, or they find someone on the street, another person here or there, someone at the school and so on, and they think, yes, that's what I want to be like. And they come back home saying, let me not even say it, it's part of a song. I just recall one word, not to say I've heard it, but the man who said it, I have heard that now he has accepted Islam, Michael Jackson. He used to say, I'm bad. So the children come home and say, I'm bad. And the mother says, what? I'm bad. Say, but what? No, I am bad. So then the parents started saying, yes, you're bad. You're bad. And now the word bad means good. What language do we understand? How can we turn these languages into something completely opposite? That is an extremely dangerous trap of shaitan. Slang language is dangerous. I mentioned it a few days ago. So dangerous that it can confuse a person. Imagine when you say, I'm bad. What does it mean? If you are speaking slang, it means I'm good. Really. And some people say, I'm cool. And others say, no, you're hot. It has the same meaning. So there is confusion and chaos. People won't know halal and haram. There will come a time when people say, you know, it's halal. They say, yes, it's halal. And then you don't know what that means. Really? Why should we create confusion in our homes? I'm giving you simple examples. But everyone would probably have examples which are peculiar to their situations, if you can fit it in. So we need to have within the home some form of a direction. And the youth, let me be honest, your role within the home is a very great role. You need to be of assistance in your house before you are of assistance outside. We know, mashallah, a lot of the youth take part in Islamic activities, take part in Islamic lectures, take part in a lot of good deeds as well. That is a duty. It is the duty of the youth, part of the role of the youth, to take part in community activities, to show an interest. We are all collectively one community. We are the Muslim community, the Muslim ummah. And we need our youth. Wallahi, we need our youth. And we need every single one of you, every one of you seated here. We need you as the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't think that this is the first time I'm coming to a public lecture, so now that's it, I'm an outcast or what have you. No, we need you, we love you, we are waiting for you, and Allah is waiting for you more than us. Subhanallah. The ulama who are here, they need the youth and they need the group. There are so many activities that are needed. We need to go out to other people to remind them about the religion. We have activities, we have departments where you can take part in once a week, once every 2 weeks, depending on how busy you are, once a day if you can, and so on. Tailor make it according to your time. That community service is something that really Allah will repay it to you, even in your own children. He will grant you happiness in so many ways. When you go out to assist others, you assist yourself in the process. When you go out to be concerned about others, you assist yourself in the process. So we ask Allah to open those doors for us. But more than that, inshallah, we need to start within the house. Sometimes the youth, mothers are waiting, fathers are waiting, they can't even lift the plate after they eat. They create a bigger mess than everybody else, than even the smaller children. Because why? They are adolescent. When they get angry, they throw the plate on one side and break it, and they're not worried. Really, it is happening. And that is the age when you need control. You need complete control. Temper control is part of the duty of the youth first, then everybody else. Because in those years where an individual is bubbling and bursting with energy, feeling that he or she has now reached a peak and is the strongest they ever were, that is the age when you need to control yourself. Allah will provide you Jannah in return. Every single one of us might feel that we are all part of the youth. Believe me, we are all dying. I don't want to sound like a person who is dooming everybody. But I am dying, you are dying. Death is not something bad. It is going to come to us. It has to. How many people are dying? So remember, the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, seize five opportunities before five situations overtake those opportunities and you regret. اغتنم خمسا قبل خمس. Seize five opportunities before five situations overtake those opportunities and you regret. What are those five opportunities? The hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam makes mention of all five items. One of them is وَشَبَابَكَ قَبْلَ هَرَمِكَ. Make use, make good use of the opportunity of your youth. Of your youth before your old age. Because when old age overtakes you, you might want to regret thereafter to say, I did not use my life, my youth properly. The other part says, make use of your wealth before poverty overtakes you. Allah's plan is one day you are rich, the next day you will be poor. That is Allah's plan. Maybe one, two generations will be rich, then one, two generations will be under zero. May Allah protect us all. So make use of your wealth and use it in the right direction when you have it before you lose it. That's a fact. Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What beautiful pearls. Make use of your good health before sickness overtakes you. That's another part of the hadith. Make use of your good health before sickness overtakes you. Whilst you are healthy, do something constructive. Many youth nowadays, obviously I'm speaking for what I have seen. Many youth nowadays seize their good health to commit sin. Then they say to themselves, now when I can't sin anymore, then I'll go for Hajj. Then I'll go for Hajj. After Hajj, if Allah gives them good health again, they say, let me sin again, I'll go for Hajj again. Like Hajj is a cloth that you are wiping a window with. Allahu Akbar. That's not what it is. Hajj is compulsory upon a person when Allah decides it's compulsory. Not when I decide and you decide. Allah says, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. Definitely, Hajj is compulsory upon those who can afford the journey. Who can afford the journey. Once you can afford the cost, you are able and capable, the next Hajj is farad for you. It's compulsory for you to go. The next one. So you apply and you try. If your visa doesn't come, you try for the next one. But you will continue trying because now it's farad on you. If you die without having fulfilled your Hajj, having been able to afford it, I don't even want to discuss what will happen. May Allah protect us. That is one of the pillars of Islam. So when Allah decided that you are wealthy enough at the age of 19 to go for Hajj, it becomes compulsory at the age of 19. And when you come back from Hajj, a sign of an accepted Hajj is that your life changes. Your life should change. You need to become very conscious of your deeds thereafter. That hadith I was mentioning just now, the next part of it says, use your free time before occupation overtakes you. You are youth, sometimes you have the time at hand. You are working for 6 hours a day. You still have so many other hours. Rather than going home or rather than going to a group of friends and doing nothing, darting around from pillar to post, you'd rather spend that time constructively doing something that you will not regret. That is something extremely important. Extremely important. We need to use our time before occupation overtakes us. Sometimes you have a lot of spare time, you haven't done anything with it. Suddenly you get occupied and then you say, oh, but I had spare time. You had. Had is past tense. So these are some of the points that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has mentioned, where he says, make sure that you seize these 5 opportunities correctly. The highlighted one tonight is use your youth, your young age before old age overtakes you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us good health to the end, inshallah. So we need to utilize our time. We also as youth, we need to be careful of the adverse outside environment. If you open the verses of Surah Al-Kahf, you will find that there were a certain number of youth who were concerned about how bad the outside environment was. And there are many narrations as to how they arrived in that cave. But the whole surah is named the surah of the cave after a certain number of youth who went into a certain cave to be protected from the adverse outside environment. And that surah is not just named the surah of the cave. It has been made such a blessed surah that it has been given virtue to be recited on specific occasions. I'm sure we are aware of that. Surah Al-Kahf. Let me mention one or two points. These youth, Allah says, they made a dua to Allah.
رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا.
Oh Allah, grant us mercy from you and prepare for us that which is steadfast, that which is good, that which is reasonable. There are many words which can translate the word rashadan. They wanted to be protected from the adverse outside environment. You know what one narration says? One narration mentions that these youth, there were a number of them who did not know one another, but each one miraculously decided to arrive at the same cave, and that's where they met. That's what one narration says. That's where they met. And they all had the same purpose. So remember, like-minded people shall always be found together. Remember that. يُعْرَفُ الْمَرْءُ بِخَلِيلِهِ. I mentioned this hadith the other day. A person is known by the company he keeps. فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِلْ. So each one of you should be careful whom you allow yourself to befriend. Your group, that's how you will be known. In fact, the hadith says you will be resurrected with your group as well. You want to be resurrected on the day of Qiyamah with good people? Be in the company of good people. It's not a joke, it is something serious. You have company where you drink together and gamble together and club together. The same club, the same gambling, the same everyone will be resurrected together also. May Allah protect me and you and my offspring and yours and the Muslim Ummah at large. And may Allah guide us. So these youth got together. Do you know what Allah says? He did them one very big favor. One very big favor. Allah says, فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آبَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا. That's what Allah says. We blocked their ears for several years in that cave. That's it. The tafsir of this verse is so deep that you can speak on it for hours. What is meant by blocking their ears? The entire outside environment was blocked, and that is what saved them. Which means if I want to save myself and you want to save yourselves from evil, don't even hear it. Don't even attempt to go near it. Keep your ears deaf from that type of mischief. May Allah protect us. Keep your eyes blind from that type of mischief. Never ever enter into something where you look at something and you know this is a complete sin. May Allah forgive us and may Allah grant us steadfastness. We are human. We err. But we have reminders of this nature in order to help us to come back on the path. Everybody might slip while they are walking. Everybody might slip whilst they are walking. But the one who will complete his journey is he who gets up and starts to walk again. He slips, he gets up, he starts to walk again. But the one who slips and does not get up and refuses to get up, will he complete his journey? No, he won't. So with us, wherever we have erred, let's make tawbah. Let's return to Allah. He's waiting for us. Allah becomes so happy when we return to Him, when we make tawbah to Him. He becomes so happy that there are so many narrations which describe the happiness of the Creator when we turn to Him. Imagine. Yet, He does not need us. We need Him. It's amazing. You know, we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say, oh Allah, I've got a problem, I need to get married, ya Allah, I've got this problem, I need that, I need wealth, I need, ya Allah, I need this, I need that. What are we doing? We are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do us a favor, isn't it? Do you know that it is only His mercy that gives it to us still? Because Allah does not need us, we need Him. When He has asked us to do very simple things, we don't want. But when we ask Him to do things for us, we want it now. Now. Allah says, I want you to read 5 salah a day. 5. And you say, ah, Fajr time, you are sleeping. You know, it's okay, it's fine. Then you wake up at 8 o'clock, ya Allah, I've got examination, A-level, ya Allah, make me pass, ya Allah, please make me pass. Allah said, but I told you to get up for salah moments ago, you don't want? Okay, never mind, my worshipper, from my mercy, I will make you pass, no problem. To test you, to see, will you come and read my salah tomorrow? When you pass, I hope celebration is not popping a bottle of champagne. May Allah protect us. Wallahi, these are realities that are happening. We have become so hypocritical, we should be shy of our own selves sometimes. And obviously I'm addressing here on a very direct level. Not on anyone in particular, but it's just a general talk. For myself. Remember, it's for myself more than anyone else. So, when Allah asks us to do these small things, how long does salah take? People who are mentioning the role of the youth, the biggest role of the youth is salah. The biggest role of the youth is salah. The day the masjid is as filled as it is for Eid and Jumu'ah, for Fajr and for Isha, that is the day we are speaking business now. MashaAllah. We are achieving something, we are getting somewhere. We will see the ummah progress in leaps and bounds. Subhanallah. And until and unless we don't achieve that, we have a lot of room for improvement. Salah is by far the most important role of the youth. Because your salah will determine the rest of your day, the rest of your life. Subhanallah. There are certain spiritual aspects of salah that are so powerful. Salah is the automatic training of a person completely. Training 5 times a day to help you to protect your gaze. Your gaze. You know, you are protecting, you are training yourself to look only where Allah wants you to look. There is nothing haram in the masjid, isn't it? Is there anything haram in the masjid? So why did Allah say, no, don't look at the wall, don't look up, don't look anywhere, just look down at one spot. And we all supposedly, inshallah, look at that spot. And we don't move our eyes from that spot. What is the significance of that? Go and see what the ulama have said. Some of the scholars of deen have made mention of the fact that that is to train us to say, if 5 times a day in your prayer you can look at one spot, because Allah told you to look at that spot, then automatically if you did it with sincerity outside salah, as soon as there is something prohibited, your eyes will just go down straight. Because you have trained yourself. It's not difficult for you. But now in salah, I have seen people, not in this country, but I have seen people where they are reading salah and they are looking, they are looking, they are looking. So much so that once I saw one gentleman nudge another gentleman who was walking past, and they said, look, this man is looking out. So that other gentleman says, okay, let's see what we can do. So they greeted him. So he greeted back in salah. He raised his hand, forgetting that he's in salah. Now, what type of achievement has this person derived from his salah? What? Salah is automatic training. You lower your gaze for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you can look on one spot in salah, naturally you will be able to look everywhere out of salah besides the places which will anger Allah. Let me give you another example of salah. Why it is? It is our training. Why it is so important? In salah, you must stand in one spot. You can't walk around in salah. Stand in one spot. But there's nothing wrong here or there. It's not like there's a pub in the front. No. You stand in one spot without necessity. You don't move. We agree. You don't move. So naturally, if I have trained myself 5 times a day, every single day, to stand in one spot without moving. In fact, if we want to scratch, we need to try not to scratch firstly. Discipline taught in Islam, no religion teaches that. And what makes a person a role model is discipline. Discipline. So if you can stand on one spot, you don't move your legs unless Allah has instructed you or allows you. When does Allah allow you to move in salah? When there is a gap in front of you. You need to fill the gap, you now walk into that gap. No one will say, why are you walking? And they know, the man is tied his hands and he's walking in the front, which means he took minimum steps, he got to that place and he carried on. You walk where Allah tells you to walk. If you can do that 5 times a day, and if you did it sincerely, then naturally when you are outside your legs, you will automatically ensure that you don't walk towards anything that is forbidden. Nothing. No nightclub, no pub, no haram, no zina, no nothing. No adultery, nothing. Why? Because your training is genuine. Genuine. Literally there is training. That is why Allah says in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Salah, if it is read correctly, will prohibit you naturally and automatically from immorality and evil. Subhanallah. Here we are. So the youth of today, obviously that topic of salah is great. The point I've made here is it is one of the biggest duties of the youth. I swear, if you want to see a change in your life, in the dini life, in your livelihood, in your sustenance, in your school results, in your happiness in the home, in anything you want to see results, read 5 salah a day in the masjid with the first takbir for 40 days to start with. And at the 40th day, you will start noticing the doors opening one by one. Subhanallah. You will notice it opening one by one. It might not come at 40 days. It might come a little bit later. It might come a little bit earlier. But I promise you, the inner contentment you will feel cannot be described to you until you do that, solely for the pleasure of Allah. You have to try it in order to receive it. And it is not impossible, I promise you. This afternoon I was speaking at a program and I gave an example to show how people are ready to do things for a haram reason. Haram reason, they are ready to do things. If a man's girlfriend, may Allah protect us from haram relations, if a man's girlfriend has to tell him at 2 in the morning, I want you to scream on the telephone, I want you to scream, he won't say, how, where, my parents are sleeping. You'll hear him say, ah, in the middle of the night. Why? He wants to prove a point of love to his girlfriend. And that also, she might break up with him. She might be doing that to another 2-3 boys. Who knows? So you'll have suddenly, maybe she told you to scream, and moments later she wants you to hear that the boy next door is also screaming. So for some haram relation, youth sometimes are ready to do absurd things. And for the relation that we are supposed to have with Allah, the most beloved to us is our own Creator who gave us everything we have. We cannot even get up for one salah. We can't read 5 salah for him. And yet if a woman tells us jump, we will jump and continue jumping until we cannot jump anymore. And still we will want to jump. Allahu Akbar. It is food for thought. It is serious and it is a current example. Very current. And it applies directly to myself and yourselves, this category. The older people, please excuse me. You know that I don't want to call you gate crashers, but I just would like to say that, alhamdulillah, we are very honored to have the elderly people around, always. Very honored. It keeps us in check, mashallah. And mashallah, they are also youth. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us realize that we have so many duties. We need to support some form of activity. We need to have something of our own. How have you spread the deen? Are you truthful? Are you honest? We were speaking about helping within the home. How good are you to your own parents? I was saying at a certain age, people divorce their parents. Imagine a son divorces his own mother and his father at a certain age. It happens in some homes, and I think the number of those homes is growing, where this is something strange and I have to mention it. To strike the balance between your wife and your mother is politics. Believe me, you need to play the game. It is a game, you need to play your cards, and your cards need to be played correctly. And they need to be played in such a way that you explain to both of them that, look, your love is the most in the world. And your love is the most in the world. But your love is slightly different from hers. And yours is slightly different from hers. And you love them the most. But maybe if you want, depending on the nature of both of them, you don't tell that to them in the presence of the other. And you don't tell the other that you told the other one that. Ma, I love you more than my wife. My dear wife, at night you tell her, my dear wife, I love you much more than my mother. But that is my mother, you cannot take her away from me, subhanallah. But at the same time, where your mother has gone wrong, and it happens. Sometimes mothers are human beings. When they see that their child is beginning to divorce them, You know what happens? The minute you marry, make sure you don't divorce your mother. Allahu Akbar. When I'm using the word divorce to depict the termination of another type of relation, which is actually a blood relation. There is no need to do that. You need to play your cards, but you need to be firm and polite. Two things. You need to be firm and polite. You cannot side with injustice on either side. The minute you side with injustice, you will receive confusion and chaos, and you will lose both of them. You need to be just. If you see an error coming from this side, with humbleness, politeness, maybe you want to get one of your sisters to speak to your mother. Maybe you want to speak to her. Maybe you want to get your father to speak to her. To say, you know what, just leave them. You know, relax. If you have a problem with my wife, talk to me. I will address her. There we are. And when your mother tells you, look, your wife is X, Y, and Z, you don't have to believe every story. Because it is natural. I told you, people are very good. Shaitan is not good. I've repeated this for the third time in my visit here. People are very good. Shaitan is very bad. Shaitan wants us to destroy our relations. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ الشَّيْطَانُ أَن يُوقِعَ بَيْنَكُمُ الْعَدَاوَةَ وَالْبَغْضَاءُ. One of the prime aims of Shaitan is mentioned in the verse I read. Shaitan wants to create adawa and baghda, enmity and hatred between us. That's Shaitan's aim. So if for any reason you are developing enmity in your own home, you must realize you are not fulfilling your role. Your role as a husband, your role as a person who is meant to be protecting both sides, subhanallah. So within the home, you need to understand, you need to strike that balance. I was making mention of that point, and I'm still making mention of it. It's taking a long time to get to it, but here we can have it now. When marrying, it is your duty to consult your parents. It is your duty to consult your parents. When marrying, it is your duty to consult your parents. It is your duty to consult your parents. Male and female, no matter how beautiful and pretty, and no matter how highly educated and connected you think you are to her, or she thinks she is to you, you need to consult your parents. If they are being completely Islamically unreasonable and you have reason to doubt their sincerity, then you may approach the ulama. What does that mean? Some parents also need help. Why? Because someone would like to get married to someone, they've proposed for someone, someone has proposed for you, for example, and the father says, no man, that man, no, I don't like him. I don't like his face. Leave him. I don't want his face. But they are religious people, they are genuine people and so on. Just because the old man cheated them, he's embarrassed now that he doesn't want any relation with them. So that happened. They've come and offered here. إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيضٌ. The hadith says, when a proposal comes to you, and this is obviously addressing the parents of the girls, and generally when a proposal comes in one direction, from a party whom you are satisfied with the level of their deen and the level of their character, then allow that marriage to go ahead if both parties, meaning if the boy and girl are happy. Allow the marriage to go ahead. If you don't allow it to go ahead and you block it thereafter, there will be great fitna and fasad and corruption on earth. Because now you are blocking marriages for other reasons. But at the same time, the youth, you know what is the problem? Fair enough, we are saying you must consult your parents when you are marrying. But sometimes, this business of falling in love is so deep and dangerous that people already start that at high school and at university, and they've fallen with the wrong people in another direction altogether, and they've been engaged in haram, and suddenly they want to come and halalize that relation. They want to come and halalize that relation and impose it on everyone. In that particular case, it will be much more difficult to convince your parents. And it will be much more difficult for you to even understand what anyone is telling you. So don't allow your heart and mind to be tempered with. And I'd like to repeat a statement which we repeat as counselors when we are counseling the youth. To say, your mind and your heart are the most powerful organs of your body. Listen carefully. Your mind and your heart are the most powerful organs of your body. Do not allow them to be tempered with in any way by anyone. Until and unless you know exactly what you are doing. Subhanallah. If you allow your mind to be tempered with, or your heart to be tempered with, or if you have given the control of your heart to someone else, you are dead meat. Dead meat. So many people become suicidal because they've given their heart to someone and that someone ran away. Your heart and your mind are the most powerful organs that Allah has blessed you with. Do not allow them to be given to anyone. No, you give them to Allah alone and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You will only utilize them where it pleases Allah and His Messenger. Your mind and your heart. Remember this. And this is valid for male and female, this advice. So many people during their youth ages, they meet someone on the internet, they give their heart away. Then suddenly they arrange to meet the person and they notice a man who's 5 times their size. Oh, what did I do? Finished. Everything comes crumbling. May Allah protect us. We cannot afford this to happen. The youth, for example, need to understand that they are the leaders, not only of tomorrow, of today, starting now. The youth are the leaders. Where are the leaders? Where are the youth? We need you, really. We need to aim high. We want from amongst you good character and conduct where people will pick up automatically that these are the leadership qualities. These are leadership qualities. People will look and say, this youngster, there is a lot of hope in him. Let's try and bring him up so we can use him in one way or another to serve this ummah. Remember, service of this ummah can be in any way and in many ways. Even if you are a doctor or a lawyer or a scientist or whatever you have, I told you, if you are a Muslim and then you are a qualified person, you will naturally serve the ummah. Muslim doctor serves the ummah. Even if he is charging them a fee, he's serving them. So long as he's not ripping them off, may Allah protect us. Sometimes you have doctors, I think within the Muslim ummah it's not that bad, inshallah. I think a lot of the Muslims, they are considerate of other Muslims, especially when they are underprivileged people, they do have a quota of people whom they also take for free. And I know that almost all the doctors do that. But at the same time, sometimes in our shops, in our businesses, in our practices, sometimes some people, shaitan comes to them, they look at the vehicle that came and the type of clothing and the smell. And someone says, but how much is this, brother? No, 3,000 rupee. And 2 minutes ago it was 300 rupee for someone else. Why? Because the smell increased the price. The dress increased the price. And oh, the car, right, increased the price. That's not the quality of a Muslim. May Allah protect us. Your price is your price. If you want to give a discount to someone underprivileged, you can. But don't overcharge just because they have money. No, that's wrong. Put your price. What is it? Charge it and take it and be happy with it. That is sustenance. You did not know who was going to come and who was not going to come. If you want to engage in an act of charity, that is your goodness. But ripping off is not your goodness. And we are not Robin Hoods. Robin Hoods meaning, no, there was a poor man who walked in here a few moments ago. I gave him for free. Now I can make my money back. Allahu Akbar. That's not right. May Allah protect us all. So there is a lot that we need to learn. The respect of the elders is something extremely important. If you respect elders, Allah will create people who will respect you. If you respect others, Allah will create people who will respect you. If you disrespect elders, you will be overtaken by shameless deeds yourself. You will be embarrassed to even face your own creator. those who respect the ulama, it is a sign of iman. ذَلِكَ وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. Those who respect the sanctuaries of Allah, the sanctities of Allah, it is a sign of taqwa of the hearts, consciousness of Allah from the hearts. You respect the masjid, you respect the places, it is a sign of the consciousness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, there was a time when females used to pass a bearded person, they suddenly draw the scarf from the shoulder and put it on their head because of the beard. And when boys who are blasting the music on their cycles or on other places, when they see a bearded person, they used to lower it. In many countries now, when they see a bearded person, shamelessly they will continue walking, and in fact they put it even louder and they look at you wantingly, like, what are you going to do? What? That is shameless behavior, and believe me, one act of disrespect can result in the downfall of your whole progeny. May Allah protect us. Man aada li waliyan faqad aadantuhu bil harbi. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be careful. If you have caused any harm to even a single of my friends, the friends of Allah, then I have announced war against you. Done. So why do we want to take a risk? Rather, we should modify ourselves to say, let me not put the scarf on my head only when I see a bearded fella. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching me constantly. Let me put it on my head all the time. Make an intention, it will happen. Let me not turn off my music now when the Maulana is there. Let me turn off the music completely. I don't want to listen to it anymore. I will substitute it with Quran, with nasheed, with something meaningful, with lectures, and with something where I will achieve benefit from. Subhanallah. Do you know that if you occupy yourself constructively, you will naturally be protected from being occupied destructively? The same applies to the tongue, and that is my role and your role. We need to play it carefully. إِلَّمْ تَشْغَلْهُ بِالذِّكْرِ شَغَلَكَ بِغَيْرِهِ. If you do not occupy your tongue with something meaningful, with the remembrance of your Creator, with something constructive, with good words, with pure words, then the tongue will occupy you with something futile, something destructive. If no good words are going to come out of your mouth because you have not used that mouth to mention the good words, then only bad words will come out of your mouth. What else is there left? There's only good words or bad words. May Allah grant us good words. The same applies to your time. إِلَّمْ تَشْغَلْهُ بِالطَّاعَةِ شَغَلَكَ بِالْمَعْصِيَةِ. If you do not use your time within the limits of Allah, then your time will use you outside the limits of Allah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. These are just pointers. These are just headlines of what the youth should be doing. And not only the youth, the message is for everyone, but more so the youth. Both male and female, we need to understand it is high time we turned to the Creator. And there are so many points that are so valid that can still be mentioned. But inshallah, we will mention them at another stage. I want to end my trip to this beautiful country with a very serious statement, which I hope you will be thinking about even after I leave. Do you know, it is not by mistake that I am sitting here. It is not by mistake that you are sitting here. Everyone, whether a person is up there or down here or outside listening or inside or listening where or where or on the telephone or what have you, or whether a person is going to hear a CD later or whatever, it is not a mistake. The hadith says, "I'lam, you should know, anna ma asabaka lam yakun liyukhti'aka." Allahu Akbar. You should know that that which got to you was never ever meant to miss you. It was aimed at you and fired at you direct, subhanallah, with you name and number, meaning you name and surname, your person. Allah wanted you to hear what I said, and He wanted me also to take heed from my own words so that I can be protected from hypocrisy myself. May Allah make me strong first, and then every one of us. So I want to let you know that before many years, when I was created, and when you were born, and when taqdeer was written, predestiny was written, somewhere down the line our meeting was written. Somewhere down the line our meeting was written. And I have not come here solely with my own free choice, but with the acceptance of the Creator, who allowed me to come here, who put it in my mind to come here, who put it in the others' minds to invite me here, who let it be a reality, and who ended coming here. So many venues, but Allah chose certain venues. It's impossible to be at every venue. It's impossible to please everyone who has invited. So this is a very, very big and serious matter when Allah will ask you, did you hear a message one day? What will we say? That is the question I want to leave you with. I am not a messenger as in a prophet, no. But I am a messenger of the messenger. Because the message I have is not mine. What I told you is not from my pocket. I told you I need it myself. And I've repeated that many times. But I am giving you a message with amana, which has been entrusted. Maulana mentioned yesterday that what he has does not belong to him. Wallahi, that's the first time I heard it being put that way, though I knew it. The knowledge of this deen does not belong to anyone. It is not franchised. It is not patented. There are no royalties upon it. Nothing. In fact, if we want to look at the term royalties, then anyone who acts upon goodness will receive the goodness, and so on and so on and so on. That is another topic on its own. But it is not blocked and sealed. I have to teach it, and we have to convey it. خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best from amongst you are those who learn and teach. Subhanallah. We need to learn and teach. So I will be asked what I did. I have to say. And if I don't say, my organs will speak out on my behalf. May Allah protect us. And Allah will ask you, not only me, but I'm sure you've heard hundreds of thousands of talks. Allah will ask you, that did a messenger not come to you? Were you not reminded of this and that and this and that? And if you don't want to answer, your organs will answer. So I leave you with the verse. أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ وَلَا يَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلُ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدُ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. Has the time not come? Has the time not come? Has the time not come for the true believers, for those who claim to believe, to now turn to the Creator? Have you not done enough of sin? Have you not committed enough? Has the time not come to turn to your Creator? What are you waiting for? How many messages have come to you? How many reminders have come to you? How many people have come to you? How many situations have come to you? How much have you been told? How much have you seen in your life? How many people have died before you? What are you waiting for? Are you waiting for the angels to come to talk to you so that you can change? Are you waiting for Allah to come to you to convince you that this is right and that is wrong? What is it that you require? Allah says in the Quran, don't be like the people of the book whom they took a long, long time before they even thought of coming, that their hearts became so hard that then they couldn't even come back to the path. So that is a verse of the Quran which I share with you, all of you, every single one of you. I am a nobody. Believe me, I am a nobody. I am not worth the dust beneath my own feet. Maybe and possibly and probably I might be speaking the English language slightly better. There is a chance. Allah might have gifted us with one thing. Maybe that is what attracted you here. Just the language. And even if it is only that that attracted you here, Allah wanted it to attract you here. Because Allah wanted you to change your life for His sake. I will be gone. The same way that the others have all gone. You remain here with the ulama of your own locality, with the ulama of your area, with those groups of individuals who are concerned about the religion. Take it up. And go further. Learn the religion. Put it into practice. Be good. Be exemplary. Be it to the non-Muslims. Interact with the non-Muslims in a beautiful manner so they can see the beauty of the deen. And they too can come into the fold. And they can understand how beautiful this religion is. And it's time for us to start behaving like Muslims. To start acting like Muslims. To put an end to everything that we've been doing. It's enough. It's enough. The reminders have come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant me steadfastness. I told you on that point I will leave you. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Subhanallah bihamdih. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin nabiyil ummi wa ala alihi wa sallim taslima. Ya Allah, ya Allah, ya Allah. We ask you to accept. To accept us all this evening, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, accept us all. Forgive our sins. Ya Allah, soften our hearts. Ya Allah, soften our hearts so that we can turn towards you, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make us turn towards you, Ya Allah. We all have a firm intention to get closer to you, Ya Allah. Help us to fulfill that intention, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us get closer to you. Bring us closer to you, Ya Allah. Be pleased with us, Ya Allah. Protect us from shaitan, Ya Allah. Protect us from the devil, Ya Allah. The devil has come and deviated us so many times, Ya Allah. Help us to recognize the devil, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, keep us away from shaitan and keep shaitan away from us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we have sinned for many, many years, Ya Allah. We have committed so many sins, Ya Allah. Recent sins as well as sins before, Ya Allah. Forgive us, Ya Allah. Grant us an opening, Ya Allah. We promise you we will not sin again, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us, Ya Allah. Guide us, assist us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, use us to serve this deen. Make us exemplary people, Ya Allah. Help us to be good to our parents, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, forgive our shortcomings. Ya Allah, we have disrespected our own parents on many occasions, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, forgive us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you to grant us goodness, Ya Rabbi. Ya Allah, you are our Rabb, you are our Lord, you created us, you know us. Ya Allah, you made us, you love us. Ya Allah, have mercy on us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we are here, we want your pleasure, we want to be happy, we want to be content, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we are weak, we cannot go through difficulties. Help us out of our difficulties. Help us out of our problems. Give us good health, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, there are people who are sickly. Ya Allah, grant them cure. Ya Allah, grant them cure. Those who passed away, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, grant them Jannah. Grant us Jannah. Ya Allah, grant us paradise the day you take us away, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, grant us paradise the day you take us away, Ya Allah. Be happy with us, Ya Allah. Grant us an easy death, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you to make us from amongst those who can deem this religion, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help our children, our girls, our boys, Ya Allah. Our youth, Ya Allah, our adults, Ya Allah. There are so many tests and trials outside, Ya Allah. There's a fitna of the internet, the fitna of the cell phone, the fitna of the newspapers, the fitna of the nightclubs, the fitna of the pubs, the fitna of the... Oh, so many fitnas, Ya Allah. Fitna as we look, Ya Allah. Fitna as we look, Ya Allah. If we walk, there's a fitna. If we talk, there's a fitna, Ya Allah. You protect us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us. Ya Allah, we are going through so much. We are walking through the fire, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we are walking through fire, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us, protect us from all the adverse environment, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us in every single way, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you to bless us. And we ask you to grant us all forms of goodness, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, protect the scholars of this deen and help them, Ya Allah. Guide them, Ya Allah. Keep them rightly guided. And make us from those who can support them, those who can listen to them, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, help us and use us to learn this religion, Ya Allah. To attend religious functions from the professionals who know about the religion, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make us from those who can read the Quran correctly, Ya Allah. Who can understand it from the correct sources, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, make us from amongst those who can become friends of yours, Ya Allah, and befriend us, Ya Allah. Be happy with us, be pleased with us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, protect this country, Ya Allah. Grant peace and stability to this country, Ya Allah. Let it flourish in every way, Ya Allah. Grant the economy boost, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, boost the economy of this country. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, we ask you all forms of growth for this country, Ya Allah, besides the growth of sin and fitna, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you to open all the doors of Jannah for us, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, accept our deeds, Ya Allah. Accept our short deeds and small deeds, which are lacking sincerity most of the time, Ya Allah. Accept them and grant us paradise through your mercy, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Allah. We have raised our hands for you, Ya Allah. We have shed tears for you, Ya Allah. We know you are the only one we turn to, Ya Allah. You are the most merciful, most kind, most forgiving. Ya Allah, you are the one who is most kind, most forgiving, most merciful, Ya Allah. Have mercy on us, Ya Allah, and accept this prayer of ours. Accept this dua of ours, Ya Allah. Anta al-musta'an, alayka al-balagh, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad.